Stand our feet and worship together.
Bye. the Lord. Our God and King is alive. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. He's conquered the grave. He's given life to those that believe in him. What a sweet truth we gather to celebrate. What a sweet God that we have that loves us. And as we continue in worship, a part of our worship is the giving of tithe and offering. And so what I'd like to do at this time is just take a minute and pray for the remainder of our service and pray for our giving, pray for our time as we open up and study God's word. And so if you would please just bow for a moment of prayer. Father, we thank you. We thank you so much that you are alive. We thank you so much that you rule and you reign. And we thank you that, Father, one day you are going to come back for us. Lord, that Jesus will return for his people and we will be with you for all of eternity. Lord, we thank you as we prepare our hearts to give. We, Lord, thank you that you gave your only begotten Son for us. Lord, we thank you that our sin is forgiven. We thank you that our eternity is secure in Jesus. And so, Lord, as we give now, may you be honored. May we give joyfully, cheerfully. May we give as an act of worship. And may you, Lord, do a work in our gathering this morning. Be honored as we worship you with our lips. Be honored as we worship you in the study of your word. Equip us, speak to us, and be glorified. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah.
You're good to me.
is good. Amen. You guys may be seated.
Well, good morning, church. Welcome to Calvary Chapel of the High Desert. Thank you for joining us. If you have a bulletin, you want to go ahead and take it out, and I'd like to point out a few things going on at Calvary here. As you open up your bulletin, a few things to let you know about so you get it on your calendar. Remember, we have the Hallelujah Night coming up on Halloween, the 31st. We're going to be opening up our whole facility for people all over the desert to come and to just have a festive time to gather, and we are going to use it as an opportunity to share the gospel. Want to encourage you to invite people out. I know just this week, my wife and I were at our neighbor's house. We crossed the street. We were hanging out, and we invited them over, said, hey, you want to come to our church on Halloween? We have this great party that we throw, the Hallelujah Party. We'd love to have you. And so just so you know, it's a great opportunity to invite somebody, invite a neighbor, invite some coworkers who have children to come out. It's a great outreach. I mean, really, it's one of the only days of the year that Dracula comes to the church. Yeah, Hanny Manny will be here. All of the Ninja Turtles, they'll be here. The Avengers, I mean, Iron Man shows up to Calvary Chapel, the High Desert. Granted, I thought he was a little bit taller, but I guess, you know, 3.5 feet is just where he's at. It really is a sweet time, and you can still volunteer in the children's ministry office. You can also help out by bringing, you know, the candy and dropping it off here. It's been encouraging to come in the mornings and almost trip over bags of candy in the hall because you're faithfully bringing candy. Might be kind of an interesting workman's comp injury. So what are you doing here? I tripped over a bag of Tootsie Rolls. But that's because of your faithfulness. So thank you so much. Keep bringing it in. Also, we're kind of in that season, you know, as October, November, December, it's the holiday season, Christmas, Thanksgiving. We have some opportunities for us as a church to continue to reach out and to show the love of Jesus and to show the thankfulness in our heart for what he's done. And so another opportunity we have is the Adopt-A-Family Ministry, another kind of community outreach. And there's several ways in which you can get involved in the Adopt-A-Family Outreach. What it is we look for families in need in our community, and we try to meet one of their needs in providing a meal for them for Thanksgiving. And so there's a couple ways in which you can be a part of this. If you know a family that's hurting, they're struggling, they could really use a meal around Thanksgiving time. There's a paper for you to fill out so we can get a hold of them. That information's at the Welcome Center, and we'll do our best to make sure they get a meal for Thanksgiving. You could be also one who helps by providing Stater Brothers gift cards so we can purchase the meals. And so there you are in Stater Brothers. You're checking out. There's all those magazines, and so you're finding out what's going on in the celebrity world, Brad who, Angelina this, and all that stuff. And right above the gum are usually those gift cards, right? There's like Olive Garden. There's Outback. Some of you are kind of hungry maybe at this point, so we'll leave it at that. And then there's the Stater Brothers gift card. You could pick up one of those, put it in your cart there, bring that to the church, and that could be used to help purchase that meal. You could also deliver the meal. You could go and deliver the meal for Thanksgiving, meet that family, show the love of Jesus. One of the sweet things that's come out of that is people will go and deliver Thanksgiving meals, and then we find in the weeks to come, they bring that family to church to attend a service and be a part of the church family. And so great outreach. Many ways to get involved. Our deadline for that, kind of our goal, is November 16th. You can get all the other details in the bulletin or in the Welcome Center. And then finally, we have this neat little box here. It's that time for Samaritan's Purse. We team up with an international ministry with Franklin Graham, and we help provide boxes for children in need all over the world. I mean, all over the world. Radical areas that they go and bring these boxes and help meet needs of children, but also kind of build a bridge to share the gospel of Jesus with these people. And so you have this opportunity in the Welcome Center. They've got several hundred of the boxes. I think they're asking if we could please just limit it to 3 boxes to start here. And you can get your box. Unfortunately, yours does not come like the demonstration box, all folded up. You get to use your origami skills. Right? Pray before you put it together so you keep your witness as you use your origami skills, right? and you fold your box together, and then you can go to the store. You can go with your children, your wife, whoever you'd like to go with, and, you know, get some items to fill it. They have some suggestions on what's age appropriate, not only age appropriate, but what to consider putting in the box, because these go to war-torn areas, and it's really a refreshment for these young children and these families. So pick up your Samaritan's purse box in the welcome center. Pack it up, bring it back. Our deadline for that, again, is November 16th also. And then with that, I'd like to encourage you all out again tonight for our series in Ruth. We're going to continue through Silver Linings. We're going to do kind of a study. So if you're single in here, you might want to come tonight, because we're going to look kind of specifically on how to deal with being interested. How do you act upon, like, hey, there's somebody. They're kind of hunky. They're kind of holy. I'm interested. Right? Or they're pretty hot looking. I mean, and what do I do? We're going to look specifically on that and see how kindness that goes beyond requirement could give you a step ahead. And then we'll also have a live Q&A after the message. So if you have questions about relationships, friendships, parenting, whatever it may be, we'll be here to do a live Q&A. So you're invited out tonight for our service. But with that, let's go ahead and stand up. Let's stretch our legs. Let's meet people. Let's welcome people. If you're new to the church family here, we're so glad you would join us, and we want to give you an opportunity to meet people in the family.
Good morning, church. You can all be seated. Just remember all the people as you're being seated that you meted. It's wrong English, but you. I didn't, you know, I'm not that smart at it anyhow, so. Let's get out our Bibles and turn to Acts chapter 17 as we continue through this book of Acts. And the title of my message today is Principles for Reaching the Lost or for Preaching the Gospel, whichever you would choose. I'll give you a multiple choice. We're in Acts chapter 17. We'll pick up where we left off last time together in verse 15 of Acts chapter 17. You guys are praying for rain, right? Looks like clouds, but no rain yet. What was worse was a couple of weeks ago, I think it was, where it looked like rain, it smelled like rain, and there was no rain. I've never had that before. So, God, please give us rain. So, let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this place that we, as your people, can gather. And, Lord, we can praise your name, and we can, Lord, fellowship together and pray for one another and encourage one another. And, Lord, open your word together. And, Lord, as children, hearing the wisdom, Lord, from their father, Lord, we want to hear wisdom from you. God, we want to know you, Lord, so that we can show you to the world around us. And so, Lord, I pray that as we open your word today, Lord, that you would again open our hearts. Lord, that you would open our eyes, that you would open our ears, that we might hear, that we might see Jesus. And Lord, in seeing him, that we might, Lord, just grow in love and in grace and just an appreciation of your mercy and your goodness to us, Lord, and that we might bring you glory. So, Lord, speak to us in this time. And Lord, I pray if there's any here that have not yet given their lives to you, that are not sure their sin is forgiven, that have come today, and they don't know with a certainty that they have that hope of heaven. God, they don't need religion. They need a relationship with you. And Lord, I pray that your Spirit would touch them, Lord, and that through your word and through the time of worship and the body of believers here, your body, that they would sense that love. And Lord, today, that they would respond and give their lives to you, Lord. And so we just commit this time to you now. We ask for your Spirit's power and presence. And Lord, that you would just do a work here in our midst. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, Paul is about to go into a city called Athens. You remember last time together we left him, he left rather, Berea, and he left Silas and Timothy there in that city. They were a people in that city who were responsive to the gospel, and not only were they responsive, they were responsible in that when Paul was preaching, they compared what he said with the scriptures. And Paul commended them. Hey, I commend the people in Berea because they searched the scriptures daily, as we saw last time together, to see if what I'm saying is true. God always commends that, and so do I as your pastor. Never believe what I say just because I said it, just because I stand here behind this pulpit. You make sure that what I say is in the Bible in front of you, you see. And you compare scripture with scripture, and you do it daily, you see, because that is the way that you grow and mature spiritually. You really can't grow very far without that kind of a discipline in your life as a Christian. And that's what a disciple of Jesus does. We open God's Word. We open it daily. And we want to take in deeply. We want to drink deeply of God's Word. And so Paul here is leaving Berea, sent away for his own safety, and he goes to the sea, but both Silas and Timothy remain there in Berea to raise up leadership, to raise up elders, and those who conducted, in verse 15, Paul brought him to Athens, and receiving a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him with all speed, they departed. And so now Paul is cruising in to Athens. And he's going alone. Athens is an interesting place. It was a kind of place very similar to our culture and place today. You see, it was a city where it was the intellectual center, really, of the world at that time. Much like Oxford in the 19th century, scholars from all over the inhabited earth would make their way to Athens. The philosophers would come there, the thinkers would come there, and there was places where they would gather, Mars Hill, one of those places, in the middle of this great city. And they would expound their philosophies. It's sort of like what you could do today if you sat home and watched TV most of the day. and you just sit and listen and just go from Oprah to Dr. Phil to Maury to CNN to Fox News to whatever, you know, The View or The Argument, whatever it is. And you know what? You just listen and always just people tuning in and just listening and listening and gathering information, watching YouTube after YouTube video and political pundit after political pundit and just, you know, always just listening and then looking for some new health fad, health craze coming out all the time. What's the new vegetable next? Whatever. I think they look for whatever is not selling, and then they call it a superfood, and then, boom, launch it into, boom, there it is, man. Everybody wants it. And so I mean, that's the kind of scene. What was going on there in this particular city. And what we have before us is the great Apostle Paul coming into that city, and head on, he begins to, well, he has a heart to connect with the people and to preach the gospel. Now, without question, Paul is one of the greatest communicators of all time. And what we are going to see in our text before us is a great example for us and some principles by which we can be effective in sharing, in preaching the gospel, because after all, that's why we're here. And so Paul here cruises into this city. It says in verse 21 that the Athenians and the foreigners who were, they were there, spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. What happened here in the city is Paul, you remember, is waiting here in this city for Timothy and Silas to show up. But while he's waiting, he is not sitting in a room, doors closed, going, "Where are those guys? Where are those guys?" like some people might do. Paul, well, he's in the city, but he's in the city. He's out in the city. He's cruising around. How do I know that? Well, because look there at verse 16. It says, "Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit it was provoked within him when he saw the city was given over to idols." Paul is cruising around in the city here, and he's beginning to gather information. As he is looking around, he's formulating a plan, prayerfully, as he cruises into the cultural center of the city, and he sees what's going on in this city. You see, if we are going to reach people with the gospel, then I got six things here, and I'm not going to get through all of them today. I'm only going to get through two, so good news, good news. Trying to change, an old dog's trying to learn new tricks. I always want to become a better preacher, and so I'm trying to manage my time a little bit better, and your time. But the first thing we see here, thank you for that. It's Pastor Appreciation Month, yeah. Okay. But the first thing we see here is I appreciate honesty, though. I can take it. First thing we see with Paul here is as he's in the city, a burden comes for reaching the people as he's looking at the condition of the city. You see, something happens here as he's out and about. We read here, was provoked. His spirit within him was provoked when he saw that the city was given over to idols. That's an interesting thing. That word for provoked means his soul was exasperated or irritated or even aroused to anger by what he observed. I wonder today if we feel the same way. You look around at what's going on. And like Paul, he saw here that the city was given over to idols of false gods, things that they carved with their own hands. And they put them in a temple, like Athena, who was in the Parthenon there, that was one of the highest hills in the city. You've seen pictures. It's got the columns around it. And there she was, this wooden statue carved out. And Paul would watch the people go in and worship and give and sacrifice to this idol. And it grieved him. It bothered him. The absolute absence of the true and living God in this celebrated city with all the false gods that were there, the demonic substitutes in place of the God that deserves worship, the true and living God, the Creator, you see, that was being prostituted. And there was all kinds of gods they had, Greek gods. If all you got to do is just go ahead and Google it, Greek gods, and look at all of them and all of the idols that were there around. And Paul saw all of that, and it bothered him and angered him because of the godlessness. I wonder if it angers you today as we look around at our culture, at our society increasingly. Does it bother you that we are in a place where we are turning away from the true and living God? Does it bother you that being taught in our schools the faith in Jesus Christ and Christianity is being attacked by our professors in the colleges, and our young people are being swayed and pulled away after a godless view of marriage and godless values? And worshiping these false philosophies, offering substitutes at every turn. Does that anger you? There's a place, people, for righteous anger. Even Jesus, who was God Himself among us, became angry at times. We know, for example, that He went into the temple at one point and He made a whip of cords and drove the money changers out of the temple and turned over the tables. Why? It infuriated Him to see religious liars ripping off God's people and preying on them rather than praying for them. It bothers me to see people that are just out for your pocketbook and just to take money out of it. Come on, give here, give here, give. And always telling you to dig deep, and they're saying the ministry won't go on and that kind of a thing without your support. And man, they're just begging for money. I mean, half their program is given to raising funds rather than raising up an army of Christians, of disciples for Jesus Christ. You see, it bothered Jesus. God is angry, and there's a place for righteous indignation among the people of God. And Paul, walking the streets of Athens, felt that anger rising in him, and he made up his mind to do something about it. Here's a problem I see today in the church, and outside the church even. In this country presently, in a very similar culture to Athens. Far too often, people outside of the church and outside of the faith only know us as believers for what we are against, and they don't know what we're for. They don't know what we're for. They know what we oppose. And while there's certainly a place, and we are certainly called to be salt and light in our culture, at the same time, people need to see and know what we believe with all our hearts. They need to see what truly we are excited about. And so many times, I think part of the problem is with our impact is we only get excited about the same things that the non-believers get excited about. Did you hear the new iPhones out? Did you hear the new Google Pixels coming out? Did you hear, hey, they got this new model of car. Hey, did you see that new couch they had? Oh, did you see the new material they have at that store? I'd love to make some drapes out of it. And we are excited to see that new TV, man. It's OLED. It's 75 inches. Man, I got to have one of those. And our faces only light up about the same things that theirs light up about. No wonder they're not seeing the light of Christ in our lives. No wonder they don't know what we're for, because in many ways we look like we're for the same things. How is it when people talk about Jesus? How is it when, you know, you see a Christian making a stand in your workplace, in any place, and do people see your face light up when it comes to talking about Jesus? Talking about His Word and His goodness and His grace? Do they see a smile and an excitement in your face when it comes to coming to church, when it comes to serving in church, when it comes to the idea of going on a missions trip and reaching out to people? Do they sense in us a burden? A burden for the people that we're around? You see, I believe this. I believe, and some people may disagree, but the world desperately needs to hear about Jesus. They need to hear about God's love and forgiveness and the hope of heaven. And people may disagree with me, but it's my contention that most people, even in our country, in our culture today, haven't really heard the gospel. I listen to a lot of preachers on TV. When I listen to preachers on TV, very seldom, and it's a very minor thing, do they talk about the cross and the blood of Jesus Christ. Very seldom, they'll talk about heaven. Very seldom do they talk about hell. What happened? What happened to the gospel? What happened to the good news? You see, I believe many so-called presentations of the gospel coming from the pulpits and over the airwaves in our country are missing some of the essentials. And thus, many people have not heard the real gospel, so they don't know who they're coming to. They don't know why they're coming. They don't know why they need the good news, because they don't know the bad news. And so there's confusion as to what they're doing and what it means to be a Christian. We need to bring them the clear gospel message. And listen, we could talk all day about various techniques we could use in telling others about Christ, and we could talk about the difficult questions that people bring up, and I could give you little pat answers to those things, like, you know, when they ask, could God make a rock so big He couldn't pick it up? You just answer me that question and maybe I'll believe. Knock it off. That's not a problem for you. Let's get down to the real nitty-gritty. At the end of the day, what's that matter? You have a burden because people don't know Jesus. You know what? Sometimes we as believers, the way we act towards non-believers, we treat them like our enemy. Can I suggest to you, saints, the non-believer is not our enemy. Hey, guess what? Donald Trump is not our enemy. Hillary Clinton is not our enemy. Oh, I can't believe you said that. You know what? They are simply held captive by Him, doing His bidding, because guess what? They don't know Jesus. They need Jesus. They need to come to Christ. They need to know that God loves them and has a plan and purpose for their life. They need to know that Jesus died on the cross for them. They need to know that their sins can be forgiven, you see, and they can be changed by the power of God. Our hope is in Jesus, and so is theirs. They just don't realize it. They're not our enemy. And sometimes we talk about them like they're our enemy. You see, we need to recognize people are lost. And do you have a burden for those that don't know the Lord? I think one of the reasons, folks, that we don't share the gospel more often with people is, honestly, we don't care. Hey, I got my Christian friends, I got my church, I'm going to heaven, I got peace with God, I know what I'm doing and where I'm going. Hallelujah. And you know what? If anybody else needs to know, they'll talk to me. And that's kind of the attitude we take. I got my little comfortable group of people and that I'm, you know, easy to live with and live around, and they don't say things that offend me and that upset me, and I like them. And so we kind of hang out in the kind of a Christian clot, if you would. You just can't break loose. That's not what we're here for. You see, you need to start if you don't have a burden for the lost. You can't make it. You need to pray and say, God, give me your heart for lost people. Give me your heart for people that don't know you, that don't know what it is to have their sin forgiven, to have the hope of heaven, that aren't experiencing the peace and the power and the presence of your Spirit, Lord, that you promised. You see, Paul, he looked around and saw the godlessness, and he was provoked. He was stirred. He was angry. And you know what? Anger's a good thing, not a bad thing, not a sinful thing, if you don't sin with it. Anger brings about energy, right? I've seen the guy angry on the road. When you're not going fast enough, I see it rarely because usually I am, but when you're not going fast enough and they come up behind you and then not only do they go in front of you, they cut right in front of you like, yeah, just eat my dust, you know. They're mad. I've seen people who are so quiet and subdued, when they get mad, they change personalities completely. They yell, scream, kick things, throw things. That's energy. Problem is you're destroying people or things and not problems. This is a perfect example. Paul was angry and provoked. What did he do with that energy that comes from anger? Well, we read here in verse 17. Therefore, whenever there's a therefore, find out what? What it's there for. You got that. Because he was angry, because he was provoked at the idolatry, he did something about it. He attempted to move out and solve the problem of the idolatry. How did he do that? It says he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews in verse 17 and with the Gentile worshipers and in the marketplace daily with those who happened to be there. In other words, he cared and he acted. He was angry, and that angry led him into an activity to seek to do what he could to solve the problem of idolatry, and that is to present the gospel of Jesus Christ, you see. Alexander McLaren, a great Bible commentator, says this, and I quote, "You tell me the depth of a Christian's compassion, and I will tell you the measure of his usefulness." With Nehemiah, it started out with a burden that led to rebuilding the walls. You know what? It starts out with a burden, people, for the lost. The second thing we see here with Paul is we need to reach our culture. We need to connect with them. We need to connect with them where they are living. And Jesus gives us a classic example of this strategy as he himself presents the gospel to two very different people, as an example. In John 3, we have a record of Jesus speaking to the heart of a very elderly, religious leader. His name, well, you know it, you've heard it, Nicodemus. You see, in John chapter 4, one chapter later, we see Jesus encounter a woman, an unnamed woman who was immoral from Samaria. She had a whole different problem. She came from a whole different place, you see. And so God shares the gospel. Jesus shares the gospel with both of these people, but he meets them at different places in their life because they were in different places in their life. They were different people. That's why there's not a one-size-fits-all when it comes to sharing the gospel. Okay, there are four things you need to do to just preach. We can give principles, but there's no steps that work in every situation for everybody. And we don't see that. We are people. We're not salesmen. We're presenting a person. We're not selling a product. That's part of the problem. You see, a lot of people, because some of us come on like we're selling a product and pushing it, people get used to responding to that. Oh, shut up. I don't want to hear it. You know, I mean, come on. I mean, I'm sorry if you do this, but if you're one of those phone, you know, salespeople. Hi, this is sometimes so-and-so solar. Yeah, I'm not interested. No, but wait, did you? No, I'm not interested. Yeah, but wait a minute. Do you know that you can get this? Well, we do windows too, and we do mini blinds, and we do cars, and we do the, you know, we'll trim your poodle. Hang on, don't hang up, please. And I go, I'm not interested. And sometimes, no matter. No, not interested. I try not to just hang up on them, but there have been times, I confess right here, right now, I confess, where I've gone, you know what? My name is no. My sign is no. The solar is no. You need to let it go. Boom! Hang up! What are you doing? When I say no, I mean no. No, you can't mean no because I got to get a sale. Sometimes people present Jesus like that. Push, push, push. And then, of course, they get the push back. That's not the way we see Jesus doing it. You see, he paid attention to where, like Paul did here, he made some observances, cruised around in the city. When Jesus encountered Nicodemus in John chapter 3, this Jewish leader, he cuts to the chase. He knows the scripture. So there's no need to go through any theological things with him, you know, as far as telling him the Old Testament stories and the pictures that were there of the coming Messiah. He just cuts to the chase. This guy, a student of God's word, and he says, hey, Nicodemus, religion ain't going to do it for you, buddy. You need to be born again. And of course, Nicodemus, in a remedial response, says, oh, go back into my mother's womb and be born again. And Jesus goes, yeah, right, Nick. What? Come on, Nick. Dude, what are you saying? No. Listen, even if you could be born again from your mother's womb and start over, that which is born of flesh is flesh. You know what, man? You need to be born of the Spirit. It's not about keeping rules and laws. It's about a relationship with a living God. It's always been about that, Nicodemus, and you need the power of my Holy Spirit. Do you recognize you can't fulfill the law and do what the commandments? You realize that you fail and fail miserably or frequently? You see, you need the power and the presence of my Spirit within you. Because the outside won't do. You can clean it up all you want, Nick. It's not going to do it. You need to be born again. Your religious views and beliefs are not enough. See, And you need to do it now, Nicodemus. You see, that's the way he related to Nicodemus. He knew all about religion. He knew all about what God desired and the sacrifices and all. And Jesus, of course, being the fulfillment of that sacrifice, who died as a sacrifice in our place. But now with the woman at the well, he didn't say anything about being born again. The immoral woman, the woman at the well in Samaria, he came there, he was sitting on the well, he was tired. Of course, we know that his tiredness was directly resulting with his appointment with this woman. And this woman comes out to the well to get water. That's what you did at a well. Not usually at noon did they come. They usually came in the evening or early in the morning. But this woman came at noon, probably because the gossip around town about her was raging. And I want you to note that Jesus talks to this woman, a Jew, in Samaria. That's, first of all, never should be. Customarily, the Jews did not go through Samaria. They'd go around Samaria because these half-breeds would make them unclean. And so for her to see a Jewish man sitting there at the well at noon, and she coming, she probably in her mind prepared herself before she ever got there. Okay, this guy's going to have some snide remark, one of those Jews. And so she gets there, all ready to be defensive. And he said, hey, you drink of this water, you'll thirst again. Why are you a Jew? A man talking to me, a woman, who you Jews, you don't even like the Samaritan. Men, I'm a woman, we're considered property. You shouldn't be talking to me, dude. Why are you talking to me? But you know what? He kept talking to her. She says, okay, well, he says, I can give you water that you won't have to come to this well anymore. And see, he's connecting the dots. She wasn't spiritually in tune to all the Old Testament stuff necessarily. She didn't know the story. She wasn't to the degree of understanding of God's word as Nicodemus was, not being trained in a scholarly fashion. So he comes to her and says, hey, I know about thirst, a thirst physically. You can relate to thirst, right? You're thirsty. You know what that's like. Listen, I can give you water that you won't thirst anymore, that you won't have to come out here to this well anymore, and man, it'll satisfy you. And she's going, hey, tap water like they have in the United States? Wouldn't that be great? I mean, that's awesome. Give me it. Bring it on. And Jesus goes, okay, but first, go call your husband. She says, sir, I have no husband. He says, great answer. I appreciate your honesty. Let me inform you that you've had five exactly husbands, married and divorced five times. And now you're just living with a dude. Who are you? This woman goes, I perceive that you're a prophet. Yeah, you're right on about that and more. You see, I love the fact that he talks to her about something she understands, physical thirst. She doesn't start talking about spiritual things, but then he begins to turn the corner and talk, I can give you water that you won't have to come here to draw from this well anymore. You see, you've been looking for love, and you've been looking for fulfillment. You've been looking for purpose, you see, through relationships with men, and they've all let you down. I alone, God alone, can fill you and satisfy that thirst. And he turns the corner and talks to her about spiritual things. You see, he relates to her in a whole different way. He adapted his message to each situation and each individual. And so that's the scene throughout the Gospels when he encounters people. We need to remember that. Like Paul here in Athens, he looked at what was going on. And then he connected the dots, and that led to him to led him to prepare his message and to relate to them in a certain way. You see, we need to be those that infiltrate our culture and in a place to find out where they're at and connect with where they're at. Not isolate ourselves. Not hide out. You see, living in a comfortable Christian culture, a subculture as we do, many times we think it to be a good day when we have little or no contact with non-believers. Yeah, I didn't have to hang around those cussing sailor mouth sinners today. So thankful for that. Why? Why are you thankful for that? You see, that's not the heart of the Lord. He wants us to invade the world of non-believers with the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ and meet them and connect with them right where they're at. We need to bring our friends. We need to bring our family. We need to bring our co-workers to Jesus. The Lord never said that the whole world should go to church. He said that the church should go to the whole world, didn't he? Isn't that what we're called to do? Paul had a burden to reach a group of people that he had apparently never encountered before, and a group of people that, well, they weren't nice. Similar to the people that you may be called to reach. Well, how do I know they weren't nice? Well, look at verse 18. It says that he went to a group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers, and he began to dispute with them. He began to argue with them, and they had a disagreement. And so some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Ever been called that? The Message translates it, "What does this airhead have to say?" Anybody treat you like that? Don't be surprised by that kind of stuff. You see, these two philosophies, the Epicureans and the Stoics, prominent there in that city of Athens, that was, by the way, one of the first democracies. What were the philosophies that were popular in that day? Well, the Epicureans derived their worldview from the founder of that philosophy, as you might suspect, Epicurus. And they believe, the idea was that they believe that the world came about by chance. And that there was no afterlife, there was no future judgment. Epicurus taught that the chief goal of man was to obtain the maximum amount of pleasure and the minimum amount of pain. I think that philosophy is still around, don't you? We all struggle with that, don't we? You see, their belief was that you only go around once in life, and so, as an old beer commercial went, that probably most of you, some of you remember, you only go around once in life, so grab for all the gusto you can. Well, some of you know it. That was the beer commercial. If it doesn't feel good, do it. Don't do it. Be sure to avoid anything that would hurt you, that would cause you any pain or discomfort. You see, the Epicureans were the party animals of the first century. And many people subscribe to that view today. They live for the pleasure, for the party, for the experience, for the rush, for the buzz. For whatever they think will bring them pleasure, avoiding anything that would cause them any kind of suffering or discomfort. We don't call them Epicureans today, but the philosophy is still alive and well. On the other side of the coin, it says here there were the Epicureans and then there were the Stoics. Their founder, his name was Zeno. You can look this up on Google if you want, by the way. In contrast to the Epicureans, they shunned the mere pursuit of pleasure. The Stoic philosophy taught that self-mastery was the goal of life and to reach a place of indifference to pain or pleasure. Zeno taught that life is filled with both good and bad, and since you can't avoid the bad, you just grin and bear it and tough it out. Stoics believed that God was in everyone and everything. He was in people, he was in trees, he was in plants, he was in rocks, he was in animals, you name it. So the goal of life was just to get through your allotted years to the best of your ability. Today, the Stoics can still be seen in the elements of both Zen and the New Age adherents. Both of these philosophies were wrong and are wrong in the sense that they both reject God. You see, not only were these people ignorant of the truth, they were also elitist and smug about it. And so they said to Paul, what does this airhead want to say? Paul being called a babbler, a charlatan. And they were saying he's like a parrot, just repeating bits of information that others have espoused. But what they were hearing from Paul was something they said here is new. So whenever there was anything new, it at least merited a hearing, so they invited Paul to come and speak to them. Gave Paul an invitation. That was going to be an invitation. It was going to be answered in a big way. When they said, hey, come and tell us, you airhead, this new thing. Okay, call me what you want. You're going to give an audience to me? Ha, I can't wait. I mean, don't you know that Paul just suddenly lit up when they called him an airhead? They probably freaked out because he lit up. But I mean, he was excited about the opportunity to share the gospel. And he gladly seized the moment, willing to walk through any open door to talk about Jesus, his Lord. How about you? How about me? Are we those who are quick to respond, you see, when the opportunity comes to share the gospel? The love of Christ drove Paul to present the good news. You know, the Bible says in John, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, he told Nicodemus, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God doesn't want people to perish. He loves them. He doesn't want to ruin your life. He doesn't want to set up laws just to make you miserable. He wants to set up lines to keep you going, you see, in the right direction. And those lines are given, their direction given out of love. When God says don't, he means don't hurt yourself. You see, if God says don't do a certain thing, he says it because he doesn't want you to make a mess. He doesn't want you to bring a pain and unneeded problems into your life. Jesus died on the cross to take the hurt for you. Jesus died on the cross to take the guilt of your sin upon himself. Jesus shed his blood that if you'll just put your faith and your trust not in men, not in yourself, and not in organizations, but you put your trust in Jesus Christ, the sinless Son of God, who hung there as the sinless Son of God so he could pay the sinless Son of God for your sins. So that he took your place and my place as the wrath of God was poured out on him. Physically, he suffered in your place, and spiritually, he died death in your place. The fellowship from the Father was broken momentarily, while the sins of the world, your sin, my sin, was dumped on him. So that our relationship, so that we could have a relationship with a holy God. The sinless Son was treated like a sinner so that we could be treated like sinless sons and daughters. That's why I know there's no other way to heaven. Nobody else could pay that price because nobody else is perfect. Nobody else always did what God wanted. Nobody else could hold up under the accusations and the scrutiny. You know what? Our political leaders and people in places of power and position today get unbelievable scrutiny that you're glad that you don't get. because I don't know how many of us could stand up against the kind and the degree of scrutiny, because we're all sinners, aren't we? And we're quick to point out, look at them. Could you believe they did that? Can you believe? Oh, come on, look in the mirror. Get out of your high horse, you know. Get off of your holier-than-thou thing. You could do it in a heartbeat, and you have done it. Come in humility, say, God, I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. I can't save myself. I can't fix myself. That's why Jesus died. And today, if you've come and you've not given your life to Jesus Christ, you know what? He died on that cross for you. And you today have an invitation to come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Man working hard trying to be good, burdened down because you failed and made a mess. Jesus said, come to me with all that. Listen, man, I'll cleanse you. I'll forgive you. I'll give you the power to change from the inside if you'll just put your faith and your trust in me and stop putting it in you and other men and stop believing in yourself. Get out of the believing in yourself stuff. Because what do you do when you believe in yourself and you fail yourself? Either you, like, commit, you know, suicide as far as, you know, your wrong deeds and just kind of blot them out. How do you get forgiveness? You got to go to Jesus. He'll blot out your sin. He paid that price on the cross for your sin. If you'll just take that step and put your faith and trust in him. So today, if you've come and you don't know that your sin is forgiven, you don't have that hope of heaven, you know what? Now's the time. Today's the day to give your life to Jesus Christ and leave here a changed man or woman with your sin forgiven, a new life and the hope of heaven. And there's no sin he won't forgive except that which you won't confess. Will you come today? Will you give your life to Christ? Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time we could spend in your word. We pray now, Lord, that you would continue to strengthen our faith. Lord, that we would be those who, as believers, have a burden for the lost. That we would be those, Lord, who are seeking to meet people where they are. And Lord, not do a cookie cutter kind of a thing, but in love, just listening to them, just observing and hearing their heart and where they're at, Lord. And then connecting in that way. Lord, help us to be those who are like Paul here. And Lord, who just care about people in that way. And Lord, a lot of times, the greatest love that can be shown is by listening to someone, by hearing them out. Your word says a fool speaks before he hears a matter out. Lord, may we not be fools. May we listen, and may we, Lord, be those who show love in that way. And then, Lord, may you give us wisdom to speak to them right where they're at. Lord, that they may know that you care, and Lord, that they may come to you. Lord, I pray if there's any today that have not yet given their lives to you, that are in our midst. God, today, they're not here by accident. They're here because you love them and you want a relationship with them. Lord, I pray that they would not walk out of this building, Lord, in the same way that they came in, but they would walk out with their sins forgiven, a new man, a new woman, with the hope of heaven, through a relationship with the one who died on the cross in their place. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, draw those that don't know you to yourself. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's all stand. if you've come and you've not yet given your life to Jesus Christ, you know what? This is your day. This is your time. This is your opportunity. And listen, the reality is you don't know you'll have another one. You never know. This could be your last day. Are you ready? Are you ready? You're ready to live. Are you ready to die? Have you given your life to Jesus Christ? If you haven't done that, you know what? He's brought you here because he loves you and he wants you to have that relationship with you, with him. He wants to save you. He wants to cleanse you. He wants to give you a new start, a new life. And if you'd like to make that step today, you simply need to come to him, confess your sins, be willing to repent and change and receive Christ. Be born again. And so we'd like to help you get started. If God's spoken to your heart today and you want to make that step right after the service is over in a moment, there's a door off stage here to my left, to your right. Behind that door is the prayer room. And there in the prayer room are people who want to pray with you a prayer asking Christ into your life. And then they want to give to you a Bible and some materials to help you understand what it means to have a relationship with the living God. Listen, Jesus cleans his fish after he catches them. You come like you are with all your sin, with all your struggles, with all your doubts even, and questions. You come to Jesus Christ and let him answer them. He will answer them, but you've got to come. And so if you want Christ, just head through that door. For the rest of you, have a great day. God bless you. Thank you for coming.